Welcome to Information Service Engineering, lecture number 4, Natural Language Processing, part 3. In this part of the lecture, we are going to talk about so-called finite state transducers. So, remember the last section of the lecture, we have talked about finite state automata. And an FSA is able to recognize, which means to accept a specific string. However, FSAs are not able to tell us more than just pure acceptance. So they can't tell us the internal structure of what they have recognized, what they do accept, like we need in morphological parsing. You remember morphological parsing? We have some kind of surface form and we want to determine the corresponding lexical form, which means we want to know what is the stem, what type is the word, and what kind of inflection of or derivation is there. So how is the word constructed? But this we don't know. We simply know whether it has been constructed in the correct way if we do this with a finite state automaton. So what we need is another kind of machine, which is a small extension of our finite state automaton, which maps, which means transduces, an input string to an output string, which encodes the structure somehow. So what we need is we have a surface form. So this is the input, like for example, here on the input tape, we have cats. And we want to create the lexical form on an output tape, which would be cat, denoting that's a noun, plus n, denoting that this is the plural form, plus pl. So how can we do that? We extend the finite state automaton to become a finite state transducer. Easy thing. So this is the basic form of a finite state transducer, FST, that maps between two sets of symbols. So it's a two-tape finite state automaton that recognizes or generates pairs of strings. So an FST defines relations between these kind of set of strings. In which way? So we have here, for example, the input, and then the second string you have here is the output. And input and output, if you use a finite state transducer as a kind of translator function with input and output, it could also be a two tape, simply finite state automaton that accepts something on two tapes. But we have here the second tape as an output tape defined. And if you write this down here in the form of a graph, you have here exactly the input and output separated by a colon. So this is simply convention. Okay, let's formalize this kind of automaton, this transducer. As we have already said, the finite state transducer is an extension of the FSA, which means this time it's also defined as a tuple, but of course a larger tuple, since we extend the original tuple of the FSA. We give it another name, so we call it T for transducer, and we add delta, which is an output alphabet, and we extend it with sigma, which is the output function. Okay, let's go through the components piece by piece. First of all, we have the finite set of states. So usually it's n states from q sub 0 to q sub n minus 1. Then we have our set of input symbols. This is sigma. And we have a finite set of output symbols. This is the new one, delta. However, again, we have to start in a specific designated start state, q sub 0. And of course, we also have the set of finite states or acceptance states. Then we define our transition function delta. And in the same way as we have already defined delta, we have to define sigma as an output function. And here we see that sigma is defined as, of course, a function of the cross product of all of the states and the input alphabet characters. And this maps to a string of the output alphabet. So this is then delta star, which is Kleinis star. We have already learned about this type of character, which designates all potential strings that can be formed from this output alphabet. So now if I apply sigma to a specific state q and an input letter I, the result will be omega, while q, of course, is from the set of states, I is from the input alphabet, and omega is from delta star, which is a string formed of the letters of the output alphabet. So this is the formalization or formal definition of a specific finite state transducer. Okay, so this finite state transducer T can also be expressed as, of course, we have some input, let's say, tape, and we have an output tape, and it defines a relation between exactly these two regular languages, the input language and the output language. So in the input language, we have now all of the surface forms, like, for example, cat, cats, fox, foxes, and the corresponding output language then should contain all of the lexical forms of exactly the corresponding words. So cat would be then cat plus n, it's a noun and it's singular, or cats would be cat plus n plus plural, because it's the plural form of cats. So this kind of mapping then will be defined, or this relation will be defined, by our finite state transducer. And it forms exactly then these kind of pairs, that cat, the surface form, will be associated with a lexical form cat plus n plus singular, or foxes, the surface form, will be associated with fox plus n plus plural, which is the plural form or plural inflection of the noun fox. So here the finite state transducer acts as a translator. It reads a string, which is the input language, and it outputs another string, which is the output language. And for morphological parsing, what we are doing here, we are reading in the surface form and we are putting out the lexical form, at least in theory. So there are more problems to solve. You will see that. Okay, so consider now we have two tapes. We have the upper tape, which is here our lexical tape with the output alphabet delta, and we have the lower, the surface tape, which has the input alphabet sigma. On the input alphabet sigma, we have cats, and what we want to have in the end, we want to create the upper output tape, where we have cat plus n plus plural. Okay, this is a challenging task. So let's see how we do that. Okay, we have here a few examples that you might see here. So let's have a look. You see here, for example, cat, you see goose and geese. So we have again in the upper part the regular nouns, in the lower part the irregular nouns. So what we have to have here now is again the surface form, which is here underlined in red, and we have the lexical form. And what we want to have here, so the surface form should be the input, the lexical form should be the output. And if you go or start now with the upper one, if we look at cat, so we read cat, and then we see, okay, cat is now finished, for example, then you continue again with an epsilon transition to another state, which simply denotes you then, okay, we have to go then to a subsequent final state, which then in the end says, okay, cat is ready and accepts. But of course, an N should be outputted there. And if we have a word ending, so this hash sign is a word ending, you will see this soon, we have to output SG, SG for singular. On the other hand, if we have cats, if you read cat, so we read CAT again, and then we definitely say it's already a noun. And then if there follows an S, we say it's a plural, so plus plural. And we can do the same thing, just watch it there for goose and geese. So it works exactly in the same way. So for, but of course for goose, what you have to do there, you have a special path only for the singular and another pass then only for the plural, where, you know, different things have to be performed. So for geese, of course, you have to determine that it's a noun and also then that it's a plural. But for goose, you have to determine it's a noun and it's singular. And what you have there, for example, you have so-called default pairs where input is the same as output. And you have so-called feasible pairs where the input is somehow transformed in another thing, which is then the output. Okay, so if you now look at the blue underlined stuff, this is a little bit different. And this is not the only thing. We also have to consider other type of irregular nouns. They are not really irregular, but the plural is a bit different. If you look at fox, for example, it works not quite the way. So fox, the plural is foxes. So if you do it exactly the same way like cat, it will not work completely. However, you will see, we will use it nevertheless. Another thing I already have told you, what you have to consider are so-called word endings. So we would have to denote that a word ends somewhere to be able to then output whether it's singular or plural. So to denote whether it's an affix or not, or also to denote that it's a noun. And for other cases, like for example, for cats, we have first of all to say, okay, we have to find out when is the morpheme at an end. So when does the word cat, the stem end, to make exactly to be able to do this N. And then to find out that cats, of course, the S then is the final word, and after S, the word is over. So S then is an affix. It's a bound morpheme. And we have to indicate first the morpheme boundary. We do this with a hat. And we have to indicate the word ending. And this we do with a hash sign. So we use hat for morpheme boundaries and hash for word boundaries. The point is, of course, in the surface form, usually you don't see morpheme boundaries and word boundaries. So the trick here is, and you will see this later on in the lecture, that we introduce a third finite state transducer, which translates the original surface form in an intermediate representation that exactly then contains the morpheme boundaries as well as the word boundaries. So especially for the case of fox here, what we have applied here are so-called orthographic rules because it has an irregular plural here. So here we have to apply some kind of orthographic rules. In English, there are several, like for example, there is consonant doubling before, let's say, the affixes or suffixes ing or ed for back and begging, for example. Or there is an e deletion, so a silent e is dropped before ing and it. So for example, between make and making, you drop the e. And for fox and foxes, we had exactly this insertion of an e, you know, after consonants like s, z, or x, or cg, or also sh, and also before s, then an e is inserted. And there are even more rules, so we don't have to go deeper into that. These are orthographic rules, and this kind of orthographic rules also have to be supported in our finite state transducer. So for the English plural, we have the usual regular form like cat, cats, dog, dogs. So there we only add an S. But for fox, we add ES, foxes. For bus, we add buses. So these are orthographic rules. And for that, we need an intermediate representation to map this to finite state transducers, to map exactly this kind of orthographic rule to a surface form, to then come up first with an intermediate representation that can be translated to a lexical form. So we have these three steps. As you see here, we start with a surface form cats. This will be translated in the intermediate form where we have the morpheme boundary as well as the word boundary. And then we have also the next finite state transducer that is able to translate here the intermediate representation into the lexical form, like we have seen it before on the slide. And the same works for foxes, but here exactly for foxes, we will apply this orthographic rule where foxes will also be translated in fox. This is then has to be identified as the morpheme boundary, and then the plural s and the word end has to be inserted. And then from this, okay, again, we can then deduce exactly the lexical form in exactly the way like we did it before. And then also this representation from before will really work. So in the end, what we have here is we translate a surface form. first in an intermediate form, where we have to take care of all of these orthographic rules that we need for the language. So this means we not only have one finite state transducer, we have probably many finite state transducers for each of the orthographic rules to look at them. And then we have an intermediate representation. And from that intermediate representation, we go via a so-called lexicon finite state transducer directly to the lexical form. So this works via this kind of an intermediate form that we have here. So this is the way how we do morphological parsing. It's not rocket science. It's a bit complicated, you see that, but this exists already for quite a while. So one famous application of this kind of finite state transducers is ELISA. I don't know who of you has already heard of ELISA. So, sorry, ELISA is a rather famous, chatbot. However, it has occurred already rather early, so already in the 1960s. So it's an early natural language processing program created between 1964 and 66 at MIT Artificial Intelligence Lab by Josef Weizenbaum, also famous computer scientist. And he created this kind of chatbot to demonstrate the superficiality of communication between humans and machines. So ELISA simulated a conversation simply by using this kind of pattern matching that we know by finite state transducers and substituting strings according to a specific methodology encoded with the help of transducers that gave the users the illusion of understanding, you know, this exactly what the user had written, and then they answered somehow. However, the framework was not really able to understand, but it was able to mimic conversation. Interestingly, Weizenbaum, so the creator of ELISA, was really surprised by the number of people who attributed human-like feelings to the computer program, including his own secretary. So ELISA was programmed to work like a psychotherapist. And you see here these kind of conversations that you can do with ELISA. You have also a link here. Simply follow the link and try to converse exactly with this kind of chatbot, and you will be surprised. And it works really simply. So I can give you one example how this works with a finite state transducer. So, for example, the human says, "You don't argue with me." And the computer would answer, "Why do you think I don't argue with you?" So typically like a psychoanalyst. So how does this work? First of all, if we get the input, "You don't argue with me," what we do here is we substitute in a sentence where "you" and "me" occurs, "you" with "I" and "me" with "you." So we have "you don't argue with me," and our first transducer creates "I don't argue with you." And the second one applies exactly this kind of rule. So we replace the entire string with the following string, "Why do you think?" And then we use the string that we have created. So the result would simply be, "Why do you think I don't argue with you?" And you see, this fits perfectly for a specific kind of conversations. And this is how ELISA in principle works. Of course, there are more rules in ELISA. And of course, if you have after several, let's say, question answering sessions you have tried with ELISA, you will see that it always answers in a similar kind of pattern. But for some people, it's, let's say, rather calm. It calms down people, and you feel you have somebody to talk to. So ELISA is really quite of a funny program. Okay, this is finite state transducers, which is, again, together with finite state automata, a first and rather important technique in natural language processing. It's a rather basic technique that has been applied now for a long time, and one of its application areas is, for example, morphological parsing. Okay, this was finite state transducers. In the next section of the lecture, we will go for another technique that we apply there. And there we try to do tokenization, which means we try to disassemble a sentence in single tokens. Okay, see you next time.